Yeah, right.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Tuesday, March 21st meeting of the Wethersfield Planning and Zoning Commission. Would the clerk help me with roll call?
Chairman Harley.
Here.
Vice Chairman Margiotta is not here. Clerk Roberts. Mr. Hughes. Nope. Mr. Oikle.
Here.
Mr. Hammer. No. Mr. Homicki. No. Mr. Dean.
Here.
Mr. Allard.
Here.
Mr. Edwards. Yeah, I see him. Ms. Antoniak.
Yes.
He's labeled.
Here.
Mr. Silver.
All right, so we have seven and everybody's participating. Item number 4.1, discussion regarding equipment screening for application 1785-12-Z for the Wethersfield High School. We have a presentation, I guess. Yes, I'm sorry. Oh. Yes, please.
Well, good evening. My name is Rusty Malik. I'm the project architect for the high school project. What I'll do today is quickly go through. You've already received these slides in a submission to the commission, and I'll just go through it. I've added a few additional slides just for your information. I'll jump through the history because we've discussed this before many times. What I want to do is really focus on where we are with the project, with the units that are on the roof of the project. This particular slide identifies the various units and the heights of these units. The ones in question are really the sort of the maroon color that face Wilkett Hill. And those are some of the larger units that are elevated slightly off the roof as well. So as we looked at this, at the screening of these units, we've tried and we've looked at various options, which include, and I think we discussed, a landscaping option where we were putting 30-plus trees at strategic locations along the property line. And then we've looked at other options as well. We've met with the neighbors, we got feedback from them in terms of what some of the approaches could be. And what I'll do is show you some images of what the buildings looked like before the high school project. And you can see this is an image from Wilkett Hill. There was rooftop equipment there then. It was visible. Well, I'll admit that it was not as large. And so that's a very key element in any evaluation as we move forward. But these are various pictures taken during different times of the year, in particular during the fall months and fall and winter when the leaves are not on the trees and the equipment is a lot more visible from the road and also from adjacent properties. So these are the various images. One of the other things that we did do is we walked through along the property, along Wilkett Hill, taking photographs of what's visible and taking this to the next level. We try to develop an option that indicated how we could screen the units. So what we'll do is we'll look at a screening option that's we call a partial screening, where two of the three units are completely screened, and the third unit is actually screened via landscaping, because that's not visible as you drive up the main entrance to the school. So in this particular scenario, What you're seeing is in red are those little, the trees identified in red are new trees, and what was being proposed is about 15 new trees. These are all 15 to 20 foot trees that'll be planted. They'll be evergreens of different varieties, so that they'll provide a consistent and constant buffer from the neighboring properties. One of the things, and we have some slides to indicate this as well, we did take pictures from the school looking out at the properties to make sure that we were catching all the spots where there was a sight line through to the individual's home. And the idea would be really that before we plant any trees, that we would go out there and do a physical test in terms of when the landscaper is getting ready to install the trees, you know, say, okay, how does, you know, put two or three of them down, and then and look at that and evaluate whether they need to shift one way or the other. And so that's the idea behind the installation of trees as we move forward. Now, here's a view that shows the two units in question. Actually, it shows all three of them, and you can see the two on the left are visible off the main drive, and the third one to the right is again between the trees and could be screened by our landscaping. So here's an example of how that could be done. What you're seeing is that there's a physical screen that's being installed on the south side and the west side, and that particular screen is hiding two of the units, and the third is being concealed via landscaping. Here's another image. And in this particular case, what we even looked at, now one other aspect of this, of the project is there are some exhaust fans that look like little rocket ships that are on top of the schools. Most science programs have science labs and prep rooms. Those require the appropriate exhaust. And so that's something that the school never had because it didn't meet code, and those are code requirements for the project. In this particular location, we have biology labs, and they were there before, and we've reconfigured them to create lab rooms in this location. We have four biology, and we also have physics labs in that area. There are three exhaust fans in that location, and they are the source. They do exhaust the fumes from the prep rooms, and are on 24/7. Now, two of the three don't have to be on 24/7, but the third, by code, has to be on 24/7 because it exhausts the prep room, and because chemicals are used in the school in the programs, that has to be exhausted. So what you're seeing is a difference, and again, I go back and just say that that's a small screen that could be placed in front of those two units as well. But additionally, putting landscaping in, putting some trees in, you can see how we can completely block the view off the units. And then here's the different, another view showing the partial installation. Now this is a view more towards the spring, summer, where the trees are leafed out.
Why did the lines look across it? Two lines in the middle of that? The other one looked blank, but this one looks like it has...
No, these are, what I want to show you next is the reason there's lines there is if you look at the panelization of the building, it's panelized and you've got horizontal panels on the building. We want this to look similar to the panels that are on the building. So there's horizontal jointing in the panels on the building. We don't want it to look like something that's, you know, out of the character of the building. So that's what you're seeing are the joints of the panels. Now these panels, and here's three different ways that...
You can't paint those because they're... joints like that?
Right.
Okay.
Now here's an example of a panel, and another panel just fits right into it, and then it's sealed.
Now, always that crevice area. Okay.
Right. That's just a joint. These come in various sizes, and so we would put them in sizes that are appropriate to the dimensions of the building.
If we tried to bolt these things to the roof, we would have had problems. Okay.
Right. The other thing is that these are insulated panels, so there is some rigidity to them. We're not going with the right, because we don't want oil panning to occur on these panels. If they're spanning, you know, roughly six to eight feet between support points. So we're going with insulated panels. And these panels also have the capability of providing acoustical treatment by virtue of the fact that you can get them as perforated or not perforated. They'll still be smooth on the front as one views it, but on the back, there'll be perforations in the panel. And therefore, it absorbs sound rather than and reflects sound. It's a combination of reflection and absorption of sound.
Sir, do you have any data or estimates of the level of the sound attenuation level that these panels would provide?
There is data on it that's coming from the manufacturer, and we can certainly provide that information to you. But the sound attenuation is, I don't believe I have the specifics on the attenuation as to how many dBs it would reduce any sound that emanates behind it. But we can get that data.
That seemed to be somewhat important, for any proposal to be in support of this installation.
So so let me just get into, and I'll come back to the sound issues just in a minute. Here are some views looking from the school at the various properties. In one version of the analysis we had, which was only being addressed via trees being planted, we had about 30 plus trees. In this particular case, we were down to 15 trees because of the screening in terms of how the screens block the view of the units, and then in other cases also the views to the property. So what you'll see is we took some photographs of the views from the building to the properties, and where we felt that there was views coming through, we're proposing planting trees in those locations to screen. So here's another case, and you can see that house there is very clearly visible, and by planting trees. So we did an analysis based on a number of trees. We've come back with about 15 trees that can be planted. Now, these will serve dual purposes. One will be to provide some screening, but the second will be to also provide some buffer in terms of the acoustics. So the more trees that are there, that they'll also block the sound from coming through onto the property. So another example of how we've been analyzing the space and planting trees. Now, we did go through and do sound readings all along the property line, and these were done at various times of the day. And what we discovered, as we would anticipate, we've got a 45 dB reading at night and a 55 during the day, impulse of 80 and up to 100. But our focus now is going to be on the 45 and the 55. What happens is during the time when the buses are, and during the day, which is between 6 a.m. and 10 p.m., the only time that we exceed that is when the buses are on site. So the buses are running, there's traffic going, there's cars coming on site, there's kids coming onto the school property, coming to school, and then in the p.m. hours they're leaving, so there's a lot of discussion, there's a lot of noise generated from just those two events. So what we noticed is that when we do the p.m. hours, you can see the numbers are going up. We have, 59, 55, 53. There was a 65 there, but these are, again, a moment in time when we're taking the readings. So we took several readings during various times during the day.
Yes. It's my understanding, or my recollection, that the town has a sound ordinance.
A noise ordinance, yes.
And I don't remember what that is. I was just thinking about that now. Do the dBs, are they consistent with our town ordinance?
So the 45 and the 55 is the town ordinance. Okay. And that's also the state. The state, I believe most of the time, most towns adopt an ordinance that's similar to what the state puts out, which is 45 and 55. So during the day, you've got 55, and I'm going to residential, because even though we're a school building in a residential zone, that's the most conservative of all the calculations. And hence, during the day, it's a 55 reading. In our case here, and that's if it's consistent noise. It's not an impulse noise. It's not a short, it excludes things like emergency the situations like a fire alarm going off and a generator and so on.
But it's in line and consistent with our town ordinance.
It's in line and consistent with a few exceptions, like when the buses are there and the buses are. So we took readings during the day at 6 a.m., 6 p.m., and we went through on various days. We did get one reading, which was at 45.4. And what we discovered is that the fans on the roof that are the exhaust for the fume hoods and the prep rooms was the source of the noise. The units themselves that are in question in terms of the mechanical units are very silent. They're very quiet. I was actually up on the roof with the building inspector and the fire marshal, and we noticed that the two particular fans that are located right in the middle of the building, I can point those out, that are located right there next to that unit, were the source of the noise. And that's where we went back and said, well, why are both these units on all the time? So we discovered that one of the two needed to be shut off. It can be shut off because it didn't serve the prep room. So we turned that unit off. And the first reading we'd received was 45.4. When we turned that unit off, we got a reading of 45.2. Now, in the acoustical world, a 0.2 is not a recognized reading. They just take the whole number. They say it's 45, because 0.3 dBs is not discernible to the human ear. So in talking to our acoustical consultants, he says, we comply because we're at 45. And whatever we do beyond that, now this is without any trees, without anything else in being put in on the roof as screening, etc. Those are the readings that we received.
How would the discretionary fans be controlled to ensure that they're only on when they have to be on?
They're programmed. Everything on the school is digitally controlled. So what we did is we had the facilities staff reprogram those fans so that they turn off at 6 p.m. And they can do that with any device that's on this school.
I think the daytime hours for the 55 start at 7 a.m., except on Sunday when it's 9. It's not 6, I know that.
We went to at different hours during the day, and we can certainly look at the hours at different times. But during the day, I mean, the one location where the sound was the highest is where we focused, and that was right in the middle of the building.
Yeah, I mean, the only reason I mention that is your 8 a.m. Sundays are over the 45 all along the north and the east. I guess the other question is, were the readings on the east taken at the top of the hill or down at the bottom?
They were taken right at the property line, okay. On top of the hill.
Yeah, because, I mean, it is louder up there than it is.
Right. Actually, we took readings down below, and they were lower. Right. They were well within, and then we went to the top of the hill. Now, we were on our side of the property. We didn't, you're supposed to be on the property owner's side of the property, and we stayed on one side. So that distance would only further, I mean, it was
be the thickness of the fence that you were
right,
standing next to.
Next to, it. Basically, it's quite minimal. So we felt that would be an appropriate reading. So to this end, what we're proposing is a screen for the two units that are as an L-shaped screen that can be anchored in several different ways. And there are two, you know, we'll look at all three options. One is with a curb. Another one is with dunnage. These will be 2 feet off the roof and 10 feet tall. As I said, they're the insulated foam panels. And along with that, there's about 200 linear feet of these panels. And then along with that, we're also proposing the 15 trees that would be planted along the various strategic locations along the property line.
How did you decide where to end the screening on the east side?
One of the discussions that took place and the neighbors were there at that meeting, is where, you know, whether we needed to carry it all the way down. And it was not a unanimous decision, but this is where the committee also came back with the decision that the two units that are towards the front of the building were the ones that everybody wanted to definitely screen, and the third unit, which is further back, couldn't really be seen even when she came onto the site for quite a ways. And that's, so that was the third unit. That extended another, required another 100 plus feet of screening because we were doing a continuous screen all the way through. So, you know, that added quite a bit of screening to that, to this, the west side there.
Where did you extend it?
So right now.
South of Sheila's house?
So right now the screening stops right there.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
And we're talking.
You're talking to, about up here then, not.
Right, that not L south. Is where okay. we're screening, and that last section there was not going to be screened.
Okay, you're talking about as soon as you tennis courts come into play, you stop the screen.
Right. Those units on the north side are much of a much lower profile. So when we went and looked at them, and there's also was a lot of landscaping that was placed on the north side of the property. So as you look at the units from the north property line, you can barely see those units.
So I guess just so we're clear, you're not proposing what you're showing here.
Yeah, this was one option that we had looked at.
Okay.
So we were looking.
Because I didn't see that in our thing.
Right.
So we actually don't have in our package, do we?
It's toward the front.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, right.
And you did consider an extra piece in front of the exhaust.
We did consider an extra piece in front of the exhaust as well.
That looked kind of silly.
Yeah, it was just something to look at. It's really, those fans are further back, so that panel would have been in line with the face of the unit that they're next to. It would make, if we're going to do something like that, it makes more sense to have it as a continuous screen.
Other questions for Rusty?
Yeah, so the final answer is to cover all three units with screening or just the two?
What the committee approved was the covering two units, the front two, the L shape. And let me just go back to that image.
That one.
So that's the line there is what's being covered.
Okay, I want to ask a question.
Plus the landscape.
Are you going to do a study of the acoustics with the screens up? Because what I'm worried about, if you don't extend it over the third one, it'll bounce noise back into the corner. And I like the idea of covering all three because it looks like a finished product opposed to we kind of sort of thought about it.
And you just wanted to say we've studied all of those options.
Yeah. George?
Yeah, back on my original question, I think those lines probably break up the facade. It's just too much. And architecturally, I mean, I think it...
Right, and they also come as panelized versions. You can't get them in 10-foot tall and...
Can't do anything about it, but I mean, it still adds to it, and that's the positive thing, I see. The more I think about it. Thank you.
So,
you sure you get all the right trees in the right places? I don't know.
I think the way to do that is really find the location in the field. And if any property owners, encourage the property owners to participate in that process so that they, you know, maybe we can go onto their property and also try to locate the trees based on where it best provides screening.
Now, these are large trees.
These are.
So we don't have to wait. They don't have to wait 5 years for them to grow to help.
No. These are 15 to 20 footers, and you know those are not. They're pretty good sized trees.
On a slope, though. Alrighty. Oh, go ahead, Yolanda.
Just a couple questions. So why again are we just? Is the committee recommending just? Screening two of the units instead of not extending it to the third unit?
Correct. After meeting with residents in this room, the meeting facilitated by staff member Peter Gillespie, there was a consensus with those neighbors that the partial screen with the landscaping was satisfactory to them, and that was the recommendation taken back to the committee, and that was voted upon. It is in part a budgetary matter to be able to extend As you know from when we were here in December, we talked about, you know, putting too many holes in the roof. That's why we're looking at the dunnage. And I was just informed about this alternative method of sheeting, so that perhaps would reduce the number of penetrations. So, you know, I'm happy to hear about that. But budgetary and also the holes in the roof, and that the homeowner who was most affected by that unit told us that he supported having the mature trees planted. And I have to say that the issue of noise was not presented to our committee. Frankly, it was before your meeting that you heard from the public. We actually had a meeting and invited the public in. We sent out 109 invitations, and I think we had five or six homeowners attend, and that was the first time that we had heard about the noise. So we've been working to address that in the short time that it's come before us, and I know that residents have been coming to you as well. So we're doing what we can to address it, but it is a school, it's an existing building, and you know, that has to be taken into consideration as well.
I just want to say I appreciate the fact that from the time we first met and talked about this and had discussions with you, both in the press and from what we've talked about, that you've reached a consensus with the neighbors. And this is a much improved situation, you know, given the comments that we first received from the neighbors. I appreciate the building committee sitting down and being able to work that out. And because of that, I'm happy, because the building committee is happy and the neighbors are happy, and I think it's a win-win for the town.
I have a couple more questions.
Go ahead. At some point, I'm gonna let the public speak.
Okay.
But go ahead, ask your question.
I just have another question, and that is, so you sounds like you're minimizing the roof penetrations.
Yes.
Is there any additional maintenance now because of these units? What kind of maintenance are we introducing now?
Yeah, there will be maintenance on these units. I mean, there's going to be damage over the years, and I think we put some information into the package, you know, over like a 15 to 20 year period. If we didn't have any screens on there, we'd still be painting the rooftop equipment, because that's, so we try to do a comparative study. These are aluminum, these are very sturdy panels. There will be some maintenance on them, but it's not anticipated of any significant amount. It really comes down to if we have some severe weather and something, you know, it flies into these screens and damages them, then you're gonna have situations in repair. There may be times when they'll need to be painted. These are factory finished panels. They're similar to the panels that are on the building, so the color consistency, it will be there, and it'll last. Those are Kynar finished panels. So where the maintenance will come is from any damage that occurs to them, you know, through wind damage or, you know, if you have a severe storm condition. One of our main concerns was over time what happens with these panels taking these lateral forces of the wind. And, you know, so that's why we've moved away from those individual penetration type anchor points, because that made many, many more penetrations in the roof. Now, the technology of how they anchor to the roof has changed quite a bit. But those individual anchor points, because we're talking about a building that's in the 1950s vintage, we were concerned there's very little steel. It's all some pretty shallow joists that go east-west on the building. Our engineers were concerned about those individual connections, and they liked the continuous sort of dunnage approach a lot better, because you engage multiple joists in that connection. And it also means fewer individual penetrations.
Okay, thank you.
And I would just, if I could note that I'm joined by fellow building committee members here this evening, Dave Drake, Peter, and Dan Camilleri. So if you have any questions for them.
Thank you. So if there's no additional questions from the commission at the moment, we have a letter. So I'll put into the record a letter from Mark and Donna Poirier. Attached our comments. Let's see. They are on away for business. So they provided to the town council a letter on March 6th, which I assume went into the town council minutes. All right. We encourage two additional considerations, both related to noise abatement. I love having to read letters and figure them out. Okay. First is to consider whether proper consideration was made regarding the noise levels at the east property boundary along their property line. The measurements are well below the elevation. So I'm sure they're thinking that the noise levels would read higher, closer to the house. Secondly, it's not clear if the selected screening is designed for noise abatement. All right. I've seen this letter. I think it was distributed by email to the committee.
It was. Yeah.
Okay. So I do want to hear from the public, and I assume that they are some of the property owners. So. One at a time, if you'd like to come up and offer some thoughts.
Hi, I'm Steve Walsh, 381 Walcott Hill. So I'm actually on the kind of upper northeast part of the property where I had the highest audio levels, I think.
So could you?
When I saw your numbers up there, I thought it said 63. It couldn't say 63, it must have 53.
Right.
So it's what's interesting about the sound levels is that although they may be highest during the day with the buses and so forth, they're most obvious in the evening and on the weekends when, of course, the few moments of the week that I'm actually outside and have a chance to enjoy the yard. And because of the general ambient sound from the street is diminished, you know, because of the traffic abated, you hear it like so much more because, like, if everybody was quiet for a second, nobody's been listening to that noise in the back in the room there inside the closed door, but if nobody talks for a second, that's what it sounds like in my house on the morning while I'm shaving in my bathroom, like 400 feet away from that one unit. So I don't know, maybe it's the fan. I don't know really what it is. And if it's the fan, that could be, you know, screen in some small way, I really don't care. That would be fine. That might make a big difference. But, you know, as far as the visual look of the thing, the horizontal reveals, I think, look nice. They're in keeping with the balance of facade across there. I think that looks nice. I think it would look best if it went all the way across to all three units. I know that there's some money issues with extending that over, and where my property is, there was actually, I think, one or two trees taken down on the school side when they put the trailers in there. So I have what appears from my backyard. And to be perfectly honest, my backyard project is comparable to what your screening project is in dollar-wise. So I have about as much at stake as you guys do. But when I look out my backyard across my pool, I have like a big hole, and it focuses directly on that third unit. I mean, that's what I see. And at night, it's like I'm looking at the cityscape right there. So it is really pretty obvious for me. However, for the vast majority of people who attend the school for functions and so forth, they're not going to see the third unit as much. And when they get down on the grounds, they're already down pretty low on grade level to begin with. So, but from my perspective, it's really, that third unit is pretty damn ugly, to be honest. But I'm more concerned about the noise level out of that at this point. Because even if the trees, and it sounds like you're going to put some fairly mature trees in there to begin with, which would probably help to screen that and maybe cut some of the sound, I will do my own on the other side if I have to screen visually. But also, as my property level goes up, even not very much from, you know, from the driveway back there, it goes up maybe 15 feet maybe to the fence line. From there up to my house is probably another 10 or 12 feet. And if I go up to the second level on the second floor, I'm like almost roof level. So it's really a lot louder there. Now, I know that this hasn't been brought up until recently, but again, you know, it's the sound levels have only been kind of, you know, really been able to look at them, hear them, in only the last like 6 months anyway. So it's not like everybody's been, you know, this wasn't something that we've been living with for years. They're kind of new units and nobody really even knew what they sounded like until, you know, now when you go out there in the wintertime at night, I went out there a couple of weeks ago and turned my phone on. It's like, I'm amazed at how loud they are. So I don't know if the units are not making noise, this fan, maybe, I don't know, there's a way to do something with that. But, you know, in general, I'm in agreement that I think the screening would look much better, obviously, than those units exposed the way they are now. If you can't do all the way because it's a, you know, an incredible financial burden, then whatever you can do along the property lines to screen it with trees, what I guess would be the next best option. But what I don't want to do is to find out, you know, a year from now it becomes such a nuisance that I do my own you know, test out in the backyard and I come up at 58 and then I come back to you guys and say, you know, what's the story here? Now you're at 58, you're over the limits all, you know, on the weekends, and what are you going to do about it? You know, I don't want to. So, I mean, if there's anything, if there is truly a way to reduce that sound and you don't, without putting that screening all the way across there, I'd appreciate it if you guys took a look at it. If you want to come on my yard and take readings, that'd be fine by me.
All right.
So, anyway.
George, you want to ask a question for him? Sure.
You've looked at the plans and the booklet, or certainly the same thing up here.
Mm-hmm.
And are you, the tree part, are you satisfied that there are enough trees down your way, or do you think they're going to be high enough? And
Again, that depends on what they put up there. I mean, if you put trees that are, you know, I don't know what kind of trees you're looking at here, but it's, I guess, a variety of trees. If they're in their 20 foot range to start with, it probably, it's not going to really, from up inside my house, you're still going to be able to see the roof line until they're up probably like 40, 50 feet. But I think it will probably have a visually, it will help a lot. Yeah.
They probably could show you what they look like other than this kind of thing.
Yeah. I mean, I design stuff like this. So, I mean, I have I think
it
will help.
Look at one at some nursery and get an idea, but mm-hmm. Of course they don't have those large trees out in the local nurseries, I'm sure, but they might. I would think you would want to look at that myself, but
yeah, I mean, I think it would be a nice idea if you did have the neighbors help to pick out some of the foliage. Now, you know, the readings of the house on the corner there, the other fellow there, I mean, it's really loud there. I mean, you just walk up from the school and stand on that corner. It's like, I don't know, you know, it's hard to know what 50 or 40 or 60 means. I mean, I don't know what 100 could mean, but that'd be awful damn loud though, I think.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you.
So, unless you've got a specific response to that.
I just want to say that's true that the house on the corner did have higher readings, but there were two fans that we did turn off, and once those, because those were not connected to prep rooms, so those turn off at 6 p.m., and then we took the readings after that, and then the only location where the readings were higher were towards the middle of the property. So those readings were under 45 at that point.
So while I've got you, what are the implications, to his point, what are the implications if, you know, next year complaints continue and the sound is higher than the ordinance? And I'm kind of asking you and Peter at the same time.
I'll let Rusty go first.
What we can do, the HVAC units aren't the problem. It's two little bulbs.
Right.
Deal with the two bulbs. There's 100 ways you can deal with those. So change the stack diameters a lot. I mean, I look at this as long as the HVAC units aren't the issue, which we've discovered just recently, they're not. Two little bulbs on the roof, I mean, they can be dealt with. I mean, so let's do this, and if we have a problem, we'll deal with those two bulbs. That's the real problem, not the HVAC units. We didn't know that a month ago, right?
Right. I mean, the HVAC units each have a 4-inch wall, which is insulated. So they were designed with the acoustical consultant to have a continuous 4-inch wall around these units. And the working parts inside are quite a bit smaller. When you walk in, there's actually like little cabins in there. You walk in and you can rent it out practically. It's so large, and you say, well, wow, these units are huge. But part of that is done for acoustical reasons, and the walls, the external walls, are 4 inches of insulation. So that's when we were up there, we were a little concerned as why were these units so loud, because that was the perception. And that's when we discovered that it was the fans on the exhaust for the fume hoods that was causing the sound. And as I said, I was up there with the building official and fire marshal, and we walked right to those particular units. The other thing is, I think the two units were side by side, and therefore the sound was probably, you know, working together and resonating and making it even louder. So now two of the three units turn off in the evening hours. They turn off at 6 p.m., and hence we're dealing with really one unit that we, by code, cannot turn off. Mm-hmm. So
that can't turn off? Because there's a stack of two in between the two units, but then...
Right, one of the two that's right here.
So there is the one that's in between those two has to stay on all day.
Right.
Or at all times.
And we looked at
to David's point, if there are physical ways of changing the exhaust vents, is that an inexpensive alternative? I can envision that it might be.
I can't imagine. I mean, it seems to me it's really good news. The HVAC units are not the problem.
Fair enough.
So if we put this shield up, and if we're still on the edge and not there, we'll take some time and look at those. I mean, the noise comes from stack velocity. That's where the noise is. We'll just go with a bigger diameter stack and slow the velocity down. There's a lot of it.
I can recognize that, you know, point. I don't know if it's true or not, but, you know, it seems like a pretty simple fix if that would be the case, right?
And I have consulted with the manufacturer of those units, and I said, well, when you run into a situation like this, what do you do? And he said, well, we've never run into a situation like that. So, because I said, maybe there's some kind of a shroud that they can put over them that's insulated. And they're supposed to get back to me, and that was about a week and a half ago, and they have not. But so that question is out there to the manufacturer. Maybe they can come back with a suggestion as to how that sound can be mitigated.
Thank you. Gentleman in the back.
My name is John Rashes, 418 Wilkin Hill Road. My neighbor, Mark Poirier, our neighbor, he couldn't be here tonight. He's a nuclear engineer. He travels all over the place, and he's in Nebraska tonight. I think he's written a half a dozen letters about this. And I just told, he asked me to just couple of key points, which I believe you have, but I just told him that I would just reiterate them. Number one, this is what he says: it's not clear if full and proper consideration was made of the noise levels at the east property boundary of the school property along our property line. The points of measurement made at the property line are well below the elevation of the direct line noise from all ventilation units relative to the elevation of the main part of our backyard and home. Thus, the noise levels measured may not be representative, low, of the actual noise level impacting our property due to the deflection of noise by the high school building. Would the town please provide us with the full engineer's report documenting the study? We would like to review the report with colleagues knowledgeable in the area of noise measurement and abatement. He said, you know, you guys are welcome to come onto his property. You're welcome to come onto my property. His property abuts the high school. And it's very loud. And I walk my dog there every night, sometimes at 6 o'clock, sometimes at 7 o'clock. It's always on. There's noise all the time coming out. And again, it doesn't impact me as much, but it's a constant noise. It's constant. And it's impacted, I think, the neighbor's quality of life. This is not how it was designed, right? It was geothermal. Number two, he says, secondly, it is not clear if the selected screening is designed for noise abatement. If not, a significant opportunity will be missed to abate the excessive anti excessive and chronic noise levels to neighboring properties. If the screening is not specifically designed for this purpose, it is important to point out that this dual-purpose screening is often used in design to dampen sound and reduce the negative impact of noise. And thirdly, last point, the screening of the east side of the high school roof should extend the full length of the roof line to assure proper screening of the air handling equipment on the roof. Partial screening would be a half measure and would not solve the concerns that we have expressed regarding our property. I mean, this is an $85 or $90 million project. The screening is going to be less than one half of 1%. Geothermal was the way it was supposed to go. This was not part of the referendum. And you guys should do it right. If there's problems down the road, a year from now, I really don't want to have to go through this again. Our neighbors don't want to have to go through this again, as far as the noise is concerned. Because it really is a big concern to Mark. And right now, the house to the right of Mark, it's empty. There's going to be new people in that house at some point. It's for sale. And the guy that lived there is 100 years old, so he just passed away. And so, I really would not want to have to revisit this a year down the road. So I just ask you guys to do it the right way. Thank you.
Thank you. Can somebody confirm, is the Poirier house on the corner? It is the corner? Yeah, okay. All right. Is there another property owner?
Good evening. My name is Mark Motter. I live at 424 Walcott Hill Road. I am, if you look at the entrance to the high school, my house is just a little bit to the south. I have an office. I work out of my home. I look directly out the front, and I have a bird's eye view at the railroad cars that sit on top of the building. I am definitely in favor of the screening and the trees. I think the trees were a very smart move. I think that's a good cost-effective measure to do that. However, that doesn't help in some cases, especially with John and Jen with their house, which is just one house north of mine. I'm in favor. I know it's a budget concern, and I'm just as concerned about the taxes and costs as everybody. I would like to see the screening go down past that second unit that's on the front of the building. I think it's a short measure to do the L shape and not go down past that second one. Whether it has to go all the way down to the tennis courts, I don't know if that's fully necessary, but I'd like to see it at least go several feet, beyond that second unit. I think that would help. But I am in favor of a lot of the design. I think it should have been done a while ago. I wish they had thought about this when they changed from geothermal to the rooftop units, but as you know, right now it looks like an industrial park. So I've got a bird's eye view of it. The noise for me is not as big a deal. I've lived there for 35 or 40 years, and I'm used to the buses coming in and out. That's just part of life. But I feel especially sorry for the neighbors who try to go into their backyard and have that constant noise. So anything you can do to add the trees in the right spot and to get the cooperation of it. If anybody wants to come onto my property to look for sighting of line of sight to place the trees, please feel free. I'm here to help, and thank you for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else? All right. Come on up. I was going to call you up anyways.
However, that the members of the public who you just heard from are the same people who advised us, and I thought we had a consensus on the partial screen and the tree. So there's obviously been a change in the position of the neighbors, and I just want that so noted for the record.
Would you come back up, Rusty? Oh, I'm sorry. Did you want to address us?
Jennifer Rashes, 418 Walcott Hill Road. I'd just like to say that you're right, Christine. I think the neighbors that were here at the last meeting did feel overall that it was a good compromise to do the partial L as well as some trees. But in further speaking with Mr. Poirier, who's not here today, and the huge impact that that last unit has on him and Steve's quality of life in their backyards, I think that it's probably safe to say that most of the neighbors would agree that if it came down to it, it would be better to do the entire east side and none of the south side, just in terms of what you see from the street, what you see as you drive down, and what the neighbors that abut the property see.
You give up the south side?
You don't see the south side from Walcott Hill Road.
The south side is what you see when you're in the whole facility. That's what you see. And then either, once you're in the campus, that's where you see that. And I understand the neighbors, but once mm-hmm. you're in,
well, you see it from the parking lot south of the main entrance. You're right. I mean, if money were no object, I'd say go the whole, cover all three, do it right. You know, it's, I don't know. It's just a shame to me that it almost feels negligent that on the part of the builder and any number of people that they knew as soon as geothermal was axed that these giant units were going to go up there, and here it is, they're packed up and gone, and we're talking about, why does it look so ugly? They knew those units were going to be 14 feet high. Sounds like they didn't get any information or spec sheets on those fans as to how loud they are, and we're talking about it now after the fact. It's just a little disappointing to me that this is the way it's been handled, and I'd like to see it done right. Thank you.
All right, Rusty. Questions for the applicant? David?
Question. Could you do it in two phases? Put the full screen in, forget about the landscaping. Do an acoustical study. It also visually blocks the units. Then, over time, have the town do the, you know, the landscape blocking if it's required by the neighbors, so forth and so on. But somehow I think just blocking the units, you'll cut the noise, you'll visually make them disappear, and you don't have to do landscaping, which, as we all know, requires maintenance. And usually maintenance slips after a while, and the trees have to be replaced, and then you're replacing them again and again and again. I'm just going for the full screen. The other thing is, will an acoustical engineer design the screens? Specify the screens, locate the screens according to the units?
We have an acoustical consultant as part of our team. He was part of discussions in the location.
There are certain screens that are designed for
These particular screens do come as acoustical screens with, as I mentioned earlier, with perforations and insulation inside them that absorb the sound and reflect the sound. So at a minimum, you know, how sound will reflect off the back of the screen and go west in the west direction, especially because these units are higher. And in particular, because the sound, as we understand it, is coming from those fans, and those are much lower. Those are only about 8 or 9 feet tall. And these screens will be 12 feet tall. They'll be 2 feet off the roof and 10 feet in the dimension of the screen itself. So there'll be a substantial blockage in front of these units.
Except the screen doesn't go in front of the fans.
It'll be in front of the fans. It'll be because where the screens are located right now, the fans are beyond them. They're sort of west of the screens.
Yeah. So I'm right. So I'm missing something. Are you saying if we extended it, they would cover the noise? If
the two, the one unit that stays on all the time.
Yep.
That's beyond where we were stopping the
right.
the current screen.
Right.
So what we looked at is a smaller screen just for that unit, which
looks kind of funky.
Kind of looks, yes. But that's the one source that could not be addressed. But these do come as perforated acoustical panels as well. So that's certainly a consideration in this process. And based on my discussions with the manufacturer, the cost of a acoustical versus the one we've looked at is that there's virtually no difference in cost.
Okay. I mean, I guess, like, the first conversation that we had here, I forget when, but it was, we were having a purely aesthetic conversation, and, you know, the conversation went how it went. Then, you know, we heard that, you know, obviously there's an acoustic side to it, there's a noise complaint, and I guess my only concern is that everything that we're treating right now is aesthetic only. So obviously there's stuff that we can do for the vents, for, you know, increasing the diameter and reducing the sound of those, but, like, I guess I would be concerned if I lived right on that corner, are we going to follow through on that? Are we going to actually treat that vent? Because that sounds like the most negatively impactful thing on the roof for the neighbors, not the visual. The visual is a negative, seemingly, for the neighbors, but the vents are probably the most negatively impactful piece that's on the roof, and it seems like we're not treating it yet. And I just, are we looking into, you know, those, the vent diameters? Are we looking into doing, even though it looks silly, putting something up there that makes the noise go away, at least more so than what it is now? I that's my only concern, is that the complaints from the neighbors the noise is worse than the aesthetic, and this conversation is still on the aesthetic only. I mean, obviously we would like to treat them both, but I want to prioritize it, and I wonder if we're approaching it in the right way.
And so your question is what I'm struggling with, because what they've told us is that it's compliant. Right?
Okay. Yeah.
And it's a requirement that, frankly, has nothing to do with if we went with geothermal or not. That is an existing building. That's the science wing. Unless we redesigned and moved it all to the other side of the building, that was the only alternative. So.
Right. So these vents would have been here
regardless,
and that's at least the noise side of the argument. If we're gonna put them in silos, we got the noise on one side, we got the aesthetic on the other, and it just, I don't know. I guess if we're having the noise conversation, we can't have that conversation without treating those vents in one way, and I don't know what we do from here. Are we going into treating the mechanicals with a different size, or are we looking into screening? Are we looking into what's the cost for putting an enclosure around the vents versus just extending the L? I realize that is expensive, and I realize that's probably
We don't know they're not compliant. No, what you should do is this should be an extended conversation only because of what we found out about those blowers. Not worried about the noise. Do the aesthetic thing. And if the noise doesn't go away, you hold us to it, we'll go back and do something with those two blowers. I mean, those two blowers are small enough, you can move them.
So we can move them.
I mean, they're only little blowers that come out from a chemical booth. That's all they are.
So what can we do? Can we run, like, pipes to the other, to the central location of the school?
I mean, it's just a little blower. It's just four holes in the roof. No. The ductwork is up, you run it.
It would be an HVAC exercise at that point.
Yeah, but so I'm saying is don't hold us to it, but I'm going to go back. It went to noise, aesthetics went to noise. I think it was just aesthetics only. Let us put the shield up, and if we have a problem, we'll go back and hit those two little blowers. I mean, Russ, that much, how big are they? What are they, half horsepower, one horsepower, that for a big, right? It's just a little.
Now, there's about 2,500 CFM coming out.
No, horsepower. I mean, it's not.
So I don't know the motors.
I'm just saying. We can deal with those after if this doesn't solve it. I don't think there's no acoustical engineer is going to tell us some calculation that two little blowers in the back of it. We can't do that until we see it. So I'm coming back to make it an aesthetic answer right now.
Yeah.
Then hold it to us if we have to go back and look at those two blowers. I think there's a lot of different solutions for that. But I hate to do a lot of stuff with that blower if we put these shields up and everybody can't hear it anymore. You know, that's what I'm saying. You know.
Well, except
we didn't know that 2 weeks ago.
Fair enough, right? Fair enough. Except that I, I don't think you're going to change the noise climate from the blowers with the screening that's proposed.
You don't think so?
Well, they're not.
Well, it's not if, well, it's certainly not.
They're not in violation.
Fair enough. If you weren't here a minute ago, that's what we were talking about.
Yeah, it would be 3 feet above the exit of those blowers with the shield.
The shield isn't between the receptor and the blower. The Poirier property and anybody to the north doesn't have a screen between them and the blower. So that's not going to stop it. Unless you go with the full length blow. If you put in the full length screen, it covers both issues perhaps. I'm just saying that there's not going to be, when you're all said and done here, the noise climate for the northern property line is, you know, east side, north side, isn't going to change because of
the
screening.
The distance on the north side is a lot farther away.
I don't know, but those are the ones that are experiencing it today.
So maybe, like I say, maybe as our group will look at this thing, and, you know, maybe we'll see if we can go a little farther up or something like that. Too. You know, I don't know how far we go, but I was going to say,
yeah, I mean, you're in right. Regard,
I'm
like,
just trying to get away, spend too much time on the noise thing because it's a different animal.
Well, right, and we're not.
And maybe we solve it, and we put down where we said, geez, we still have a problem, let's go back and do something with that one that low, which should be.
And yeah, the mechanicals that are up there now aren't violating a noise ordinance, but if there are complaints from the neighbors and it's truly like a ductwork exercise just to get it into that corner and then have it underneath, you know, within the sound abatement L.
I need to know what standard we're going to be held to, because right now we're in compliance. Are we going to be held to a greater standard?
Just addressing neighbor complaints, no?
You're not in compliance at 8 a.m. Sunday, according to what was presented to us.
I just need to know what we're going to have to hit for measurements.
I should clarify that when the 8 a.m. Sunday reading was taken, all three fans were on. We didn't discover that till after the 8 a.m., so the last set of readings, when we took them, that's when only the single fan was on.
And you don't have any readings before you did the new vents and the new, you know, the new facility. So we're not really comparing anything. You know, please don't get upset. But it seems like we don't really know if we've, it sounds to me like we've made the noise worse, whether we're in compliance or not. It seems like I'm stating a fact here. We're making the noise, it's worse now.
I don't have the data, but I can tell you that the units that were up on the roof, there was no insulation on any of their units, yep. And there was window air conditioning units on that, and they produce a lot of noise. So if I were betting, I would have said that prior to this, the noise level was higher.
From a financial standpoint, yeah. If we go with the full screen, then we're not going to be able to do the landscaping or not the plan that's been brought forth. That plan was taking into consideration Mr. Walsh's property, and that was the area that we were having mature trees. That was the conversation about that unit not being extended all the way. So if we are going with the full screen, then I would ask you to take another look at the plan for the trees.
Mm-hmm. How much more cost is it if we did extend that screening from what you're showing right now? Are we doubling the cost?
The cost based on a dunnage approach was about $110,000-$115,000.
Additional
in order to extend the L all the way.
Right, it's about 100 linear feet.
And what's the landscaping cost?
The landscaping cost is about $15,000.
And the total package?
So the total package is about 100 and, I think it was 185 to 200,000 with contingencies.
But what is proposed?
185 for this plus the landscaping.
Plus the landscaping.
But if we add the additional?
We add the additional, then it's 285 plus the. So it was roughly, we were at 300,000 for that.
All right.
It was like a ballpark.
All right. Any additional questions? I guess personally, I'm of the opinion that I could see my way clear to, you know, accepting the proposal with the understanding that something's going to, you know, that somebody should be looking into the noise a little further. I personally think the landscaping is more important than the screening itself. I think the screening is funky to begin with. I'd rather there be more planting and, you know, that kind of stuff, and less screening. I just don't find it aesthetically pleasing to begin with. So, but the noise issue just hanging out there, I get it, it's compliant, but if there's something that we could do, something the building committee could do to change that noise level, I think it'd be worth, you know, at least putting it on the record that we're asking them to do that if we were to approve this plan as presented. Others?
Mr. Chair, I have some similar feelings or impressions that you've just reiterated. Having gone onto the property and listening to those units, you know, day after day, it would seem that can certainly, diminish the use and enjoyment of the abutting property owners to their own properties with that. And I'm very hopeful that the screening that's been proposed is going to, you know, reduce the noise levels significantly. Because if you look at the data that's provided in the little booklet, that even though they are below the 45 and 50 decibel standards, all those numbers are approaching those limits. And have that noise, even in its most reduced form, day after day basis, would I think be considerable significance to those adjoining neighbors that are going to have to endure that.
It's acceptable, but it's at the max, and that's never desirable, right? That's your point. This is correct me, what are we looking for? It's really, I suppose, we're just really approving their plan right after the fact.
You are approving condition number 16.
That's what it was.
Of the application number 1785-12-Z, which required them to provide a roof plan to determine whether any proposed mechanical equipment may require additional screening. So that is the specific matter before you. So as somebody crafts a motion, should be crafted in light of condition number 16.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, a question. Is a decision from us imperative for tonight, or could that be delayed until such time as they've more or less completed their proposal and provided some way of listening? Because we don't really have, I think, all the information that is necessary for us to make an informed decision.
So what do you believe is missing? I'm sure the applicant believes they've got it all.
Is the manufacturer's data gives sound attenuation information with regards to the screening that's being proposed that's going to be up at those units.
Well, I'm going to go back to the point I was saying before. The screening products are not between what appears to be the noise and the receptor of consequence. So it doesn't even matter, does it? We're screening for aesthetic purposes.
Because right? According to what the architect indicated this evening, the screening that's going to be on the roof by those units will have sound attenuation features. And the manufacturer for that does have data that can indicate the noise reduction capabilities of that. I'm sorry?
There's no data available.
There's no, I thought the architect had indicated.
You can do the DB through a panel, but you know, way here, panels way over there. There's no to make a calculation to do that.
Right, there's no panel between the primary receptor. There's no panel between the noise emitter and the receptor.
I'm going to go back. I think you got to worry about the aesthetics and hold us to the noise and say, you guys didn't fix it, then we'll go back and fix it. I don't know. There's no way anybody can make that type of calculation. I don't know how you do it.
Okay, well, I guess my impression was an error, but my understanding was that there was some engineering data that the manufacturer...
If you have a panel and you put noise there, you can figure out the noise on the other side of the panel. But that's not something that's 30, 40 feet away with a top. I don't know. That's something you do sometimes in assessment.
Yeah.
So, again, and if someone did that calculation, I wouldn't believe it. I mean, I'm just saying, if someone said this calculation would give me time, I wouldn't believe it. So,
well, I just can't get off of this because we do noise walls when we do the highways, and it starts with the whole idea that the noise wall is between the noise maker and the receptor, and there is no noise wall being proposed here between the noise maker and the receptor anyway, so there's no calculation to do.
The idea, if we get a wall up and we look at it and said, geez, we didn't quite do it, we fixed the blower, you got to hold us to it. I'm with you. I'm just trying to keep going.
Right. It seems to me that the screening that's going up, just by nature of its material, has a sound attenuator property
which is fantastic.
But the noisemaker is the vent. Can we get the vent somehow behind the attenuator? Like, we can start talking about that.
Absolutely.
You know, eventually in the future.
So, 30 feet to the left, the bat blower.
Can we move the sound?
What's the extension necessary to get past those blowers?
Not even extending the screening, but you know, sort of circumventing and getting the vent to actually make its noise behind the L-shaped attenuator that we have.
It's like a dryer vent.
Yeah, exactly.
Move the dryer vent over.
Move the neighbor's house.
So let's. I know our recorder is not going to pick up a lot of this, but go ahead.
I'm just curious, if you want to stick with the aesthetics, the architect, do you have a preference about the look of the screening, whether it was the full length, take money and sound and all that out of the equation completely? Would you be more inclined to put the whole horizontal band across the full length, or do you like it better with just the short L?
That's a loaded question for an architect. No, I mean...
Well, that's the answer,
I think
then.
That is the answer.
The answer is, that aesthetically, if you were going to look at it, it would be the full length. But there's other factors that come into it. I mean, there's a lot of things I like to do on buildings which I can't afford to do, and so I have to...
Yeah, I guess just personally, I mean, I think it's kind of unfortunate that we're talking about 0.1% of the cost of the project to extend the thing and potentially deal with both the sound and the aesthetic issues once and for all, you know, by having it go past the other rooftop unit. Mm. That's just my personal view.
Mm. Is that a motion, Rich?
No.
No, the problem is I agree with you that the cost over the overall project is small. If the money is not there, I think we have to deal with that issue as well. And it would just seem to me that the suggestion made by David is if we adopt this and we have some kind of special condition on that noise, we're going to hold them accountable to do something to that, which can be enforced. Maybe it's because I, from my experience, I just see some of these sound studies. Haven't been happy in the past with the level of sophistication of some of these sound studies. So we can go out and get all the sound sophisticated engineers to come in and give us answers,
and half the time or three quarters of the time I found they're not accurate anyway. And if we did this and just give it back to them that there was a, as a special condition, it's something which can be enforced. I think that's probably, from my opinion, the way to go. And because we don't know what's going to happen when the screening is up. And perhaps they can gerrymander that somehow to put that sound behind the screening and solve this. But to have this go on for additional studies and additional costs for engineers to come back with studies, which I'm not necessarily going to believe anyway, I think is a waste of time.
Would it matter if it was a lawyer you were talking about?
Of course. Can you,
the engineers on the panel here are getting a little... No, I can't argue with Rich's point, though. I mean, it would be kind of nice to just do it once and for all. And but if budget's not there,
well, I'd like to see the panel extended all the way to the end for that additional cost. And I understand that. You know, it's my opinion and my philosophy is like you do it. In my opinion, you do it right, and it is additional money. But it's not a temporary condition. It's not like we're investing this money for a year or two or three. It would be around for a number of years, and I think it would look better. It would reduce the noise, and I think it seems like it's a viable solution. I mean, that was the approach I wanted way back when you first came forward, but I was concerned about all the roof penetrations. It sounds like you're minimizing those as much as you can with what you're proposing. So if it was up to me, I'm in favor of extending those panels and, you know, recognizing the fact that it's additional cost. That's just my thought.
Well, would anybody like to make a motion?
You make a motion. Dave make a motion.
Dave?
Not that Dave.
Extend the roof panels.
Like you.
You wanted something simple? I'll give you one. Yeah.
So go ahead. You've heard what other people are thinking. So say it again.
Extend the roof panels to the end of the right piece of equipment.
Okay, so that's what you think is the right solution. So you're making a motion consistent with...
Sound, if it helps the sound, that's good. If that can be accommodated, fine. But I don't think we need to put conditions in on that.
So this is referencing application 1785-12-Z for the high school, and specifically condition 16. And your recommendation, your motion is to... revise the proposal to encompass the third roof unit, and in so doing, hopefully capture the noise issue with it.
Correct. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a second on that?
I second it.
1, 2, 3. Okay. Any further discussion on that topic, Tom?
I can tell I'm wavering between authorizing or accepting that proposal versus the remarks that Dan had made about a condition if what's proposed doesn't attenuate the sound, that be a condition to this that would be subject to further work in the future to make sure that attenuation or an attenuated standard would be met. At any rate, I'm not happy, as I'm sure that even the building committee is probably not happy with how this whole issue has turned out. We're still in more of a situation where this matter is what it is, and I certainly would not want my vote to be interpreted as an endorsement, but more of an acceptance of the fait accompli. Mm-hmm.
So
then you can always amend a motion. We don't do that around here. I've seen it done in 10 years, but it can be done. And we can vote on that separately.
Well, if it doesn't pass, if the current one doesn't pass, if this one doesn't pass, I guess we can turn around and consider that. So what are you guys thinking about the landscaping? Yeah, I mean, you heard the applicant request that, you know, we cut back on the landscaping. Personally, I mean, I get it. I think it's the right solution. I'm just looking to be a little more cost conscious. I don't know what the budget is for the project. I don't know if we're over it. I don't know what, quite frankly, the expenditure means, and maybe we could still ask the applicant about that. I'm under the assumption that we're short of money and we're just trying to piece together something. If that's not the case, there is a solution.
I'd like to have him state on that. He didn't seem to want to do that, really. I didn't think.
Sorry, I'm not understanding the question. Is it the budgetary question that you're asking?
The project budget. There are people here that are proposing that we spend the extra money to do it. So what does that mean to the budget?
Is the very end. This project is at the end. And we waited on the screens for a final decision to see where our other costs came out. So this will take us to the end. It will impact the final purchase of computers. But we'll work it out. We just need a decision. Because these folks, we have contracts that have ended. We are in closeout.
We got a small list of little things we want to do. And if you take that, we'll do a little less of it. I mean, the point is we want to kind of keep going.
In other words, you want a policy decision by us, and you'll try to work with it. You expect you can, and if you can't, you could come back, theoretically.
Okay. I guess if that's the question, I would rather use 20-year bonds to finish the roof than to buy computers.
That's why I like the idea of putting the special condition in rather than mandating the extension, because it gives some discretion to attempt to do this, but hold them within the reins of the sound, of improving the sound. I certainly would hate to say that, and I know this commission shouldn't make a decision based on solely on money. Mm-hmm. I mean, we can't do that. But at the same time, it's hard to keep that, you know, to forget it.
If they hear
the word that we're not going to be able to buy computers for technology because of trees and landscaping, it's a mixed emotion to me, quite frankly. And I'm not prepared to make that decision. So I think that if we do this and give the burden back to the building committee, they're going to have to, that the sound has to come in with certain levels. It's their responsibility to do it, and it can be enforced. That puts the burden back on them, and I think that would work.
So the applicant has suggested that they are compliant, however. So what would your criteria say? We want you to be 5 decibels below the criteria, something like that, just make it better? So, I mean, it's just...
Yeah, I understand.
I'm with you, right? That's where I was saying.
In the back of my mind from the beginning, I've always looked at the sound ordinance only because we hold the rest of the town accountable to the sound ordinance. And so it is the town council that a number of years ago, because I think it was the city fish or the trucks at night or whatever it was, that was my recollection anyway, that established a standard for an ordinance for sound. And I just find it difficult to make decisions based upon that may be stricter or different than what our town council has established as an ordinance for sound. And I've been taking that into consideration during this discussion. That was my first question to the architect, you know, when we started this conversation, because of that ordinance.
So you would be...
You want to say...
You would want it open-ended. It would just be better than it is today. That's mm-hmm. what you would do.
You want to put in this, it shall meet 65 decibels?
No, that's not part of this one.
If we end up extending it,
Where?
Just property line? To your...
You'd extend it.
No, extend it past the third one.
Dunnage all the way to the property line, no. If we extend the wall out to the end of that northern unit, then by virtue of the sound attenuation of the material that we're putting up there, we're making it better.
Yeah,
that doesn't make it worse.
Right, the presumption is, right.
That makes it worse.
It could make it better. You're right. But I'm also taking into consideration, whether I like it or not, the cost and its effect at the end of the budget, and this is it. And determinations are going to have to be made, potentially made between computers and trees and so on and so forth. And I'm taking that in consideration because that's also part of the budget for the building committee. So that if we increase the wall, they're going to very well have to reduce it other places.
Okay.
I guess as far as I'm concerned, this is, and I don't know if anybody else agrees, but this is like the one chance that they're going to do something to the roof. You got to buy computers every 5 years or however many years. So if we're going to prioritize it, I feel like if you're doing something to the roof and you have an ultimate solution in mind, you should probably prioritize that versus... I struggle with it too. I understand what I know exactly what you're saying, but you know they're up there, and if they do a truncated L like that, this is probably the only chance.
So this motion will not include any trees.
So that's what I was going to ask. I just want to clarify for the motion purposes, okay? We've said we want to extend it over the third unit, and that'll cover the exhaust fans. Are you suggesting you would also allow them to take the trees out? That would
take the...
Take the landscaping out?
Not do the trees?
Is that your motion? And I don't know if we got a second of it.
I'd rather not.
My understanding is that the motion was to accept the plan that the building committee has proposed to us, with the exception of extending the screening to the far or last major...
I'd rather have it made that way.
So thank you. So George, you made the motion, right? Tom, are you seconding it as that, or did somebody else?
No, Yolanda did.
Yolanda, you seconded it. Thank you. So is that your understanding? Is that what you would like as part of the motion? We're extending the thing, the trees stay in. The landscaping stays in. Extend it and leave the landscaping in. So we're expanding the scope of the project. Are you comfortable with that second? If not, Tom will.
I'm not comfortable with that.
Mr. Chairman, they understand, of course, if they don't like this or they get back in their meetings and kind of conclude they can't follow this, they can come back here and talk to us again.
I guess, but I can't see a reason why they can't extend it. That was part of the option. So Yolanda's reneging on her second. Tom, are you going to second that motion? Extending, but the landscaping stays in.
That's my understanding of what the motion was originally for purposes of moving this issue forward, I'll second it. I don't know if I'll actually vote for it, but I'll second the motion.
I'm confused as to what the motion is.
Are you? I was a little surprised with the response there, but...
second, but I don't approve it.
The motion is to expand the scope and just add to the length of the screening, all right? And the landscaping stays in. All right. So all those in favor, please say aye and raise your hand. George,
aye.
David. So I'll name them, Dave and George and Tom and Yolanda. Oh. And
I did, yes, I have my hand.
Is it up or down, Ryan?
It's totally up.
Ryan. Okay, so we have six. All right, and I'm a nay.
I'm a nay.
All right, so have you got that? All right, so you've got six positives. You're good to go with the extended screening. Okay?
And the landscaping.
And the landscaping. Yeah. You have an answer.
Good.
All right, thanks.
Good luck.
Kids are messed up.
What?
Go.
All right, so we have any staff reports?
So we'll just do the minutes. Minutes are from last week. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of us are here. 7 out of the 8.
Make a motion to approve the March 7th minutes.
What are you saying, Mr. Chairman? I'm sorry.
Second.
We have motion to approve the minutes.
Oh, yeah, they're perfect minutes.
Excellent. So all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right. So
can you add that George said they're perfect?
Only Dave Edwards was not here. Okay, so 7-4. 7-4. Wise guy. All right. Anything else? Thursday we have...
Aqua Turf Palooza.
Thank you.
All right. And anything else? The next meeting
next
is...
Next meeting has, at this point, I think 4 items.
Wow.
So your agendas will start getting more lengthy.
Any particular reason? Have we been...
There's been a bunch of pent-up applications that are now finally being submitted and getting processed.
Are they not... They're not RVs, though, right?
No, we don't have any of those.
Commercial vehicles?
No, commercial vehicles. I want to leave you in suspense. Sheds? I want to leave you in suspense.
Oversized
so.
Sheds?
All right. Motion to adjourn, please.
So moved.
Thank you.
Second.
All in favor say
aye.
I
understood what the motion was.
Aye.
I'm confused.
Were you comfortable with you?
I second, but I don't approve.
I'm sorry about that. Congratulations.
Who was the other day?
What did you
Tom. Got?
I'm so much. Yeah. Mark. What if you just put in all the dumb video and only put the panel in the front? That was the email.
It changes the whole thing. One time, a client of mine actually